Are you passionate about medicine? Do you love Harrison Medicine? Assure presents to you ABCD in Medicine, Harrison-based conceptual teachings, 100 live classes over 10 months, 100 minutes per class. Check out our website for faculty profile and attractive offers.
Welcome you all on behalf of Assure Foundation. So I am Dr. Navinath. So I'm sure that so all of you have seen the flyer and would be very much interested in knowing about what this ABCD is. So before we go into the presentation per se, I thought we'll have a few words about Assure. Yeah. So Assure Medical Foundation. So if you see, it is a group of like-minded doctors. Okay, so not very old people, so you can see me. So most of us are in our 30s and late 20s. Okay, so it is so it's a group of like-minded doctors. So most of us are graduated from some of the best institutes in the country. So the AIIMS Delhi or PGIM or Chandigarh or Jipmer Pondicherry, NIMHANS Bangalore. So what we all thought together, so all of us had lots of passion for teaching. And so what we all thought was that we wanted to teach what we had learned from these institutes to as many doctors as possible. So this was the major intention which we all were having, but we were not getting the right platform and we were not having the right way to do this. So, but slowly we started the process. So this started off by a few of our seniors in the year 2019. So it started off by guiding students and counseling them and all those stuff. So regarding a few terminologies and what we do at institutes and all those things. And slowly we started having classes. So unfortunately, we have come to the day and age where in order to bring in students or to teach anyone, we have to tell them we are going to do something with relation to entrance coaching and all those things. And many of them asked us to help them prepare for entrance examinations. So that's how the process started in 2020 when we started having classes based on Harrison. So Harrison is a text, it's a great textbook. It's almost like a Bible for anyone interested in medicine. And understanding Harrison is not something easy. So so people wanted us to discuss about Harrison with them. And slowly we started taking classes for DM and MCH training programs. But still the core part which we all wanted to do was to do something for the love of medicine. So to go beyond what everyone else is doing. So to go beyond just entrance coaching and all those things, just MCQ and all those things. So once you understand the concept and once you understand the concept behind each disease and the various factors, you understand the disease better and ultimately you treat the patients better. So for that very purpose, we thought of this program. So this is something where we'll be discussing about topics in medicine. So this we are trying to be teaching it for someone who's in the final year MBBS, a medicine student, right up to someone who's maybe doing their MD medicine or in their postgraduate days. So because of the varied audience, so there might be something which is very basic for some of y'all, somewhat a slightly higher range for some of y'all. But I'm sure that we will make it in a way in which all of y'all enjoy. Okay, and because the numbers are going to be high, we might not be able to allow you all to speak everything at the time. So I would suggest you all go through the class. Okay, if you have any doubts, make a note of it. We can discuss about the doubts and the various things if we have towards the end of the class. Okay, so that's regarding the class. And what is the goal? So what is the vision in Assure? See, at the end of the day, we don't want anyone who's hungry for knowledge to go starving. Okay, so we want to help as many people as possible. And ultimately, we want to stay in touch with all of y'all. So when we as doctors start doing an ethical practice, a proper practice, and start helping patients, at the end of the day, the patients are the ones who are going to benefit from it. Okay, so even our students who have qualified from Assure, like many who have written this DM entrance and MCH exam, many of them have cleared it. And so they're all still in touch with us. So when they see patients, they do still ask doubts to us and we have interaction. So it is learning together. It's not me teaching you something. It is me learning from you and you learning from me. So that we want to continue. And so that is our goal with this Assure Foundation. And that's the very reason why we had started this. Okay, so that's it regarding Assure. So in the coming days, you'll be seeing one faculty after another. So I just happen to be one of the faculties who's just going to start the ball rolling. So I am Dr. Navinath. So a few words about me. So I'm a nephrologist. Okay. So I did my undergraduate training from Madurai Medical College and Government Rajaji Hospital. So I don't know if anyone from Madurai Medical College has come here. So that is my alma mater. Yeah. So this picture, so I wanted to show this picture. So this picture was sent to me by a senior very close to me. So this picture almost summarizes what we want to do at Assure. Okay. So every expert at one time was a beginner. Okay. So we reached this level of perfection after many mistakes which we did. So we want to train you all so that you're able to reach the level of perfection much earlier. So hopefully we are able to do, and that will benefit you as well. So that is the main thing which we want to do. So yeah, so this is my undergraduate college. So I always start any presentation by mentioning my teachers, the patients, and my friends. So all of them are extremely important. So none of us can claim to be a great person or anything without the support or help of these people. So I always start off by thanking my teachers, the patients, and the friends of both Madurai Medical College, where I did my MBBS, and All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, where I did both my MD Medicine and DM Nephrology. So I was working as a consultant in nephrology at Velamal Medical College Hospital in Madurai for 3 years. And currently, I'm working at Rela Institute and Medical Center in Chennai. So currently, I'm based out of Chennai. Okay, so that's it regarding me. So without boring you all any further, we'll jump right into the discussion for today. Okay, so today's discussion, as you all know, is going to be somewhat a case-based and interactive session on chronic kidney disease. So I have divided this topic basically into 5 heads. Okay, so the basics, then the most of my concentration is going to be on management of CKD, and a few slides, few practical points which most of the textbooks fail to explain. So that is something you'll start to understand only once you start practicing about CKD. So a few words about that. And yeah, just to make it interesting for you all, I have a small session or just something like a quiz like thing on CKD, whatever I'll be teaching towards the end, and a conclusion slide. Okay, so let's start off with the basics. Yeah, so the building blocks for you all to understand. So why is CKD important? If you see, latest papers say that the prevalence of CKD is as much as 18 to 16% of the world population is affected by chronic kidney disease. So what do you mean by chronic kidney disease? So I'm sure that most of you all have some knowledge in medicine and some knowledge about the functioning of the kidney. So as you all know, kidney is a huge filter. So whenever you talk about a filter, you know the filter has two functions. A filter is supposed to put anything which is unnecessary from the body outside the body and keep anything which is necessary inside the body, right? This is what any filter does. So kidney being a filter, in the body, what it does is that the unwanted waste product, that is the nitrogenous end products of protein metabolism, etc., is supposed to be thrown out of the body, and the things which is needed in the body, like protein, etc., should be retained in the body. But when the kidney starts to dysfunction or gets damaged, opposite happens. So the body tends to accumulate waste products, that is the nitrogenous end products, and or we lose protein, etc. Okay, so this is how kidney disease is defined. So there is a definition, I'll be showing that. And early detection, see, not only chronic kidney disease, any illness, if it's detected early, management becomes easy because you can anticipate the complications and manage the patients accordingly. The sad part with the kidney disease is that you don't have any drugs to improve renal function. So what do we mean by that? So I told you, when a patient has kidney damage, the nitrogenous end products are going to increase. So you don't have some drugs, you just prescribe one drug and the kidney function improves and creatinine comes down. This does not happen. There is no magic bullet. So all you can do is prevent progression in chronic kidney disease or prevent rapid progression of renal failure. So that's all your drugs and management can do. So that is why early detection plays a very important part in managing these patients. Apart from that,
I have a question.
We'll have all questions towards the end. If I start answering a question in between, it will be very difficult. Okay, so don't worry. You please make a note of all your questions. We will discuss all the questions towards the end, okay? Yeah, so we'll continue. So chronic kidney disease, per se, the other important problem is that it increases the risk for all-cause mortality, especially cardiovascular mortality, and the patient can land up with end-stage renal disease. Now, please understand. So this is a rookie mistake which many beginners can make. Not all chronic kidney disease is same as end-stage renal disease. Okay. So end-stage renal disease is a subset of chronic kidney disease. So nowadays, so Harrison has a line saying it's a depressing term, end-stage renal disease. So what do you mean by end-stage renal disease? It's a severe form of chronic kidney disease or the end stage of renal failure where the patient cannot be alive without some form of renal replacement therapy, that is dialysis or transplant. Okay. But not all the patients with chronic kidney disease are end-stage renal disease patients. So when I was a student, when I was studying MBBS and all those early days, I used to think any patient with kidney failure is one who's needing dialysis. That's not the case. Okay. So don't have that mindset. I'm sure the ones who are doing post-graduation and towards the, if you're a final year MBBS, you know this point. But for some of you who might be juniors, for them, this very. And the other important point is when the patient has a combination of chronic kidney disease and diabetes mellitus, the mortality rate can rise as many as sixfold. So we'll be discussing about these things as we go forward. Okay. So this is an important slide. So if I ask you all a question, how do you define CKD? So most of you all will tell me the answer, sir, the patient who's having an elevated creatinine. So that's one point which all of us are quite aware of, and that's the commonest parameter which is used to determine kidney function. But if you look into the definition of CKD, it's very clear. There are two things which I want you to concentrate on. One, abnormalities in kidney structure or function, point number one. Point number two, there is a duration for at least 3 months. So both of these things should be there. So you should be able to show some abnormality in either the kidney function or the kidney structure, and this abnormality should persist for at least 3 months. Okay. So how do you measure this kidney function? So there are three ways. One way is the GFR or the glomerular filtration rate. Okay. The glomerular filtration rate being less than 60 ml per minute per 1.73 meter squared for 3 months. So, or patient having proteinuria, which is measured by an albumin creatinine ratio, or some marker of kidney damage. So what do you mean by marker of kidney damage? So in your MBBS days, you might have learned about nephrotic syndrome, nephritic syndrome. So nephrotic syndrome is a patient who's having a massive proteinuria. Okay, a nephritic syndrome is a patient who's having some inflammatory changes in the glomerulus resulting in presence of RBCs in the urine, or some tubular syndromes, or persistent urinary tract symptoms, asymptomatic urinary abnormalities. So what do you mean by this is some microscopic hematuria, or some abnormalities in urine examination, or asymptomatic radiological abnormalities. So the commonest classical example for this category would be a patient with polycystic kidney disease. So you might have read about polycystic kidney disease. So these are patients who have two large enlarged kidneys with multiple cysts. They might be having a normal renal function, but still they will be classified as CKD based on this criteria because they have persistent renal radiological abnormality. Okay. So understand, CKD definition is not only dependent on creatinine. Actually, creatinine does not even show in the definition. So basically, GFR is measured using creatinine. Okay, so that's the indirect way. So I'll come to that as well. Okay, so understand the basics of this CKD definition. This is very important as we go forward. So this table, I'm sure all of you all know. Okay, so I'm sure they would have had a short note. Every MBBS class, whenever they teach in medicine about CKD, this table is very often repeated. Okay. So this is the CKD classification based on GFR categories. So you have CKD staging, CKD 1, CKD 2, CKD 3, 3A, 3B, 4 and 5. Okay, so 3A is between 30 and 60 GFR, and 30 to 45 is called as 3B, and 45 to 60 is called as 3A. So this is something which I'm sure all of you all have learned in your theory classes. So one point I want you all to understand over here. I told you a patient can be classified as CKD only if the GFR is less than 60, if you remember. But see, in CKD stage 1 and stage 2, you have a GFR which is above 60. So when I was a student, I used to wonder, how is this possible? If the patient's GFR is above 60, he is not even a CKD. Then why are we saying this is CKD stage 1, CKD stage 2? But understand, that's why you need to understand the definition of CKD. What did I tell? These patients might be having some other abnormality. like maybe a persistent proteinuria, or maybe he's having some radiological abnormalities in the kidney, like an ADPKD patient. So these patients will come under this category of CKD 1 or 2. But if they don't have any renal abnormalities, in that case, these patients don't have even a CKD. Okay, so this you should understand very well. But this is theory. But if you see in practice, almost no nephrologist or no physician would ever label a patient as CKD stage 1, CKD stage 2. Not, it's not wrong if you write it like that in your prescription. But usually in clinical parlance, those such terminologies are not used. Okay. I'm audible, Deepa. Neela. So the various risk factors for CKD can be classified as modifiable risk factors and non-modifiable risk factors. Okay, the modifiable risk factors are the ones which are you might be seeing in your day-to-day practice, like diabetes, hypertension, previous history of AK, and this is a very important history you should always take for a patient with CKD. Whether the patient is taking any NSAIDs or whether the patient is taking alternative forms of medicines like homeopathy or some Siddha medicines or something like that. See, not all alternative forms of medications are wrong. Okay, so if the patient is preferring to take them, it's definitely they are right to take. But some of these medications tend to contain heavy metals. So that is something which you need to take from history and try to understand. Okay. So don't go out with the thought process that all forms of alternative medicines are wrong. No, that's not what I'm trying to say. Okay. So understand. And you can also have some non-modifiable risk factors like family history. Again, the classic example would be ADPKD or elderly patients. So it's very important. With age, the GFR tends to decrease. So once the person's age goes above 40 years, per year, there is a fall in GFR physiologically by almost 1 ml per kg per 1.73 meters squared. Okay, so this is a very, very important MCQ and it's there in Harrison as well. So you should always, understand the GFR according to a patient's age. So that's what this means. And regarding age, race, okay, so fortunately in our country, we all consider as non-black race. So, okay, so it's simple in our country, but in the US, again, you have blacks and non-blacks. And so accordingly, the GFR tends to vary. So this is again based on studies. I'll come to that. Yeah. So what is the commonest cause of chronic kidney disease? So I'm sure all of you all know this answer. This is again a very famous MCQ asked multiple times in MBBS times. The most common cause and a large chunk of CKD is due to diabetes mellitus. Okay, and the second cause is hypertension. So I told you, these two are the only modifiable risk factors we have, and these two are the commonest cause for CKD. So we should always put our energy in trying to manage these causative organs, diseases. The other less common conditions would be like glomerulonephritis and cystic diseases and all those things. So they form a smaller part when you compare the entire picture. So my class is going to focus in a big way on patients with diabetic kidney disease and hypertensive kidney disease because they are the ones whom you will be commonly seeing in your day-to-day practice. And they are the ones who have certain important caveats in treatment. Okay, now, see in this entire presentation which I'm going to take, if there's one point I want you all to take home, that would be this point. So I want you all to concentrate. Okay, so after this class, I want you all to calculate eGFR for any creatinine value you would see. Okay. So why is this important? See, many of us tend to say that a patient is having chronic kidney disease or acute kidney injury for that matter based on the creatinine value. So, but if you see the definition of CKD, I had clearly told you all, it's based on eGFR. Okay. So what is eGFR? So eGFR is estimated glomerular filtration rate. Okay. And it is calculated from the creatinine value and it just measures the filtering capacity of the kidney. Now, why measuring eGFR is very important is because of this relationship between eGFR and serum creatinine. If you see, in the early stages of kidney dysfunction. For there is a large change in GFR when compared to a small change in creatinine. That is, a patient who it might take a few days or weeks for a patient's creatinine to become 8 from 4, but it takes years for a patient's creatinine to increase from 1.2, 1.3 to 1.6, 1.7. So that's what this slope tells you. But the human brain is like that. When you see a creatinine of 4, you are like, okay, chalo, it's not that big a number. But when you see a creatinine of 8, you are panicking. Oh my God, the kidney is really not functioning. But if you see this graph, it's very clear. When you calculate GFR from the creatinine, the GFR for a creatinine of 4, you can see over here, is not much different from the GFR for a creatinine of 8. So that's why whenever you see any creatinine value, even if it is 1.2, 1.3, always try to measure the eGFR. And nowadays, all of us have a smartphone in our hand. There's almost no one who's using the old-time mobile phones. All of us always have a smartphone in our hand. And you can have an app. There are so many apps to measure eGFR. Okay, there are many formulas for that. The simplest and the formula which is recommended the most is the CKD EPI formula given over here. It is based on a few very basic things. Age of the person, the sex of the person, creatinine value, and race. So if you put in these four parameters, you will be given the eGFR. And based on the eGFR, you can classify the patient into whatever type of CKD. We have seen the classification earlier. So always calculate eGFR for every patient. This is one lesson I would like you to take home. Okay. So the next thing, so the other important parameters, whenever we talk about CKD, one is the eGFR, the second is ACR or albumin creatinine ratio. So this is measured in the urine. So it is used to measure the amount of protein which is getting excreted in the urine. So it's cumbersome to measure 24-hour urine protein. So if you're able to measure a 24-hour urine protein, well and good, great. But it is actually not that easy. Okay, so that is why we have, so the albumin creatinine ratio, what the creatinine in the urine does is it adjusts the albumin for the varying levels in the urine concentration. Okay, so it is like a cheat code for the 24-hour urine protein. So that's all. So if you are able to measure 24-hour urine protein, you should go for it, but it's cumbersome. Many patients are not able to completely collect the urine. So that's why we always do the ACR, which is much easier. Okay, and you always try to prefer the first morning void if possible. Okay. Yeah. So the next point which I wanted to emphasize on was this CGA classification. Now, so if you have seen proper discharge summaries of a patient with a chronic kidney disease, it always has three components in the discharge. One is the GFR category. So that is that stage 1, 2, 3, A, 3, B, 4, and 5, which you see. So CKD 3A, 3B. So that is called the G class or the GFR class. It should also include something called the A class. So that is the albuminuria class. So that is A1, A2, A3. So A1 is less than 30, A2 is 30 to 300, and A3 is greater than 300. So I'll be showing that in the next slide. And C is the cause for chronic kidney disease. So many times if you see in practice, you might not know what is the exact cause for chronic kidney disease. When you don't know the cause, you can always label it as unclassified. But if you know the cause, you're supposed to put in the cause. So if it is diabetes, then you can put diabetic kidney disease. So this again is a picture which is there in Harrison as well. And it is taken from the KDGO guideline. So this is called the CKD heat map. And here, based on the CGA classification of the patient, basically the G and A classification of the patient, they will come in one of these boxes. Now, so this tells what are the chances of the patient's CKD progressing or having a worsening in renal function with time. Okay, so the higher categories, that is higher the A category and higher the G category, the higher chance of the patient progressing to end-stage renal disease. So they will need more closer follow-up and you should be a bit more careful. The ones in green are patients who may not even be considered a CKD if they have no structural abnormality. Okay, so that's what this says. Green is low risk and if no other markers of kidney disease, there is no CKD at all. Okay, so this point I've already explained in the GFR area when I was discussing. This is very, 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 very important concept. Okay. So CKD, CVD, diabetes link. Now, CKD is a disease multiplier. Now, what do I mean by this? See, let us say you have 10 patients with diabetes and chronic kidney disease. The chances of these 10 patients, how many patients among the 10 you think will progress to end-stage renal disease? Let us say around 1 might progress, but 4 or 5 of them might die because of a cardiovascular disease. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. So when the patient has earlier stages of CKD, let us say a CKD stage 3 or a CKD stage 2 or something like that, these patients are at a higher risk of dying with a cardiovascular disease, that is like an MI or a stroke or something like that, rather than progressing to ESRD. So that is why it is very, very important to screen these patients for some cardiovascular problem or something like that, because these patients are at a higher risk for dying due to some cardiac illness. Okay, so this is a very, very important concept and you need to understand that. Okay, so coming on to the management of CKD. So I told you all, I'm going to concentrate to as much as possible on the management of CKD. So the general management of CKD, I told you there's no magic bullet for management of CKD. Okay, so it's not that you have a single drug, you give the drug, the patient will all improve. Unfortunately, we don't have anything like that. So it's going to be a hard grind. So you have to treat the reversible causes of CKD. Okay. So the motto is going to be to prevent or slow the progression of renal disease. Okay. Treat the complications of chronic kidney disease. The next part is very, very important. Adjusting the drug doses according to EGFR or creatinine clearance. Now, very, very important. This is one part where many of us somewhat oversee, which should not be the case. And as a nephrologist, my concern is going to be the last point. So preparing the patient for renal replacement therapy. Now, so this is something which most of us are unable to do because many times the patient land up with end-stage renal disease, you have to immediately start them on dialysis. So that should not be the case. So we should be able to pick up more cases of CKD and screen them so that we are able to identify who will progress to ESRD and prepare the patients for that. In such patients, the outcomes are much better. So what do I mean by that? You see. So I told you we'll be having an interaction. So this is a clinical scenario. Let us say you have a 60-year-old man. He's a chronic kidney disease. I told you, you have to give the CGA. So he's a G3B, so CKD3B patient. Albuminuria category of A2. So that is in between 30 and 300. He's a hypertensive. He has stable angina. He's coming for a follow-up visit. So he's been on follow-up for quite some time. And his EGFR has come down from 57 to 44 over a period of 13 years. His blood pressure is okay. What do you think about the blood pressure? So we'll come to that. It's 135 by 72. He's on multiple antihypertensives. I'm sure most of you all have finished pharmacology. So valsartan is an ARB. He's on amlodipine and he's on indapamide. Now, the question I'm going to ask you is, among the four categories which I've shown, which category do you think will need the lowest BP targeting? That is, among these four patients, for whom will you target the lowest acceptable blood pressure? So is it for a patient who's having CKD3A with a proteinuria of around 10 milligram, which is actually almost normal? Or is it for a patient who's having critical bilateral renal artery stenosis? Or is it a patient who's having quite a heavy proteinuria of around 3 gram? Or is it for a patient who's having repeated falls? So what do you think? I think we can unmute them. What do you think would be the answer? So for whom do you want to have a lower BP target? That is, for whom you want to have a better BP control? If you have to take a wild guess, who would the answer be? Or you can tell in the chat box. I hope you can understand the question. I'll be explaining this point in the next few slides. No guesses? Right, okay. So I think it's disabled. So the answer is actually option C, which is for a patient who's having significant proteinuria. So for patients who are having proteinuria, the blood pressure targets are targeted towards the lower side. So what do I mean by that? So I told you, in CKD, it's all about managing risk factors. So the first and major risk factor which we can manage would be hypertension. So that is blood pressure control. So most of the patients with chronic kidney disease, if you see, will be having uncontrolled blood pressure. And it is absolutely essential to control their BP to certain targets or goals. Okay, so what are these goals? So these are the goals which are given by many guideline societies. Okay, so for a patient with albumin creatinine ratio of less than 30, so that is almost normal albuminuric, you can target a BP of somewhere around 140-90. But for those who are having higher degrees of proteinuria, it's always better to target a BP of slightly lower 130 by 80. But always remember, my teachers used to often say, guidelines fail at the level of an individual patient. Okay, so you should always individualize targets. So if you have a patient who's, let's say, elderly, frail, and all those things, according to their comorbidities, you might have to maintain slightly higher BP because these patients don't tend to tolerate lower BPs that well. So they can be prone for falls and all those things. Okay, so this is very important. So what is the BP goal you need to do? That's what we have seen now. And what type of drug you need to use? So that we'll see a bit later. Obviously, the preferable agent would be ACE inhibitor or ARB. So why? We will see that. So now, see, I wanted to discuss something slightly above the general basics. So where do these numbers come from? This 130 by 80, 140 by 90. So when I was a student, I used to often drink. Why can't it be 150 by 80? What is the mistake in having a BP of 150 by 80? Why should it be only 130 by 80? So where does all these numbers come from? So these numbers have all been given by most of these standard guidelines. Like you have the KDIGO guidelines, the American Heart Association guidelines, the American Diabetic Association guidelines, the European Renal Best Practices guidelines. So there are so many agents world over which come up with guidelines. We also have the Indian Society of Nephrology, Indian Society of Nephrology and the Indian Society of Hypertension guidelines. Okay, so based on these guidelines, we have this value. To go a bit deeper, how do these guidelines come about these numbers? So I'm sure you all went through community medicine, okay, in your MD days and MBBS days. And at that time when we read community medicine, so it was all numbers and for many of us, it was over our head. But the concepts which we read in community medicine is absolutely important. Okay, so we had learned of something called as trials, if you remember. And nowadays, very commonly you hear a term evidence-based medicine, right? So there used to be these green boxes in Davidson when I used to read. So evidence-based medicine, that is these numbers are all from data, from studies which are conducted by various governmental organizations or various pharma companies and all those things. And based on the data which they collect, these numbers have come. So there is definitive data to say that when a patient BP is controlled at a level lower than 130 by 80, especially when he's proteinuric, the outcomes are better. Over here, the outcome which we are studying is renal progression, that is CKD progression. Okay. The last trial which was published was Sprint trial. It's a great trial. You can see the numbers. Almost 10,000 people were studied. So such a huge trial. And this trial clearly showed that when you target a lower BP, that is less than 130 by 80, the outcome, that is the worsening kidney function, doesn't happen that much. So you should always try to target a BP of less than 130 by 80 based on this trial evidence. It's not necessary for you to remember all these names. I'm just trying to show you that there are studies like this. Okay, so now let us say you have another patient. So now you have seen BP control is important and to what level and for what type of patients, at what level you should be targeting. The next question. Let us say you have a 46-year-old woman, type 2 diabetes. She's coming for the second appointment. She's a CKD 3A, age 3. Okay, so she seems to have a significant proteinuria. She's having a diabetic kidney disease. She has no orthostatic symptoms. She has no chest discomfort. Her BP seems to be well controlled. It's in your target range, 118 by 75. She's on atenolol and chlorothalidone. Laboratory testing reveals a GFR of somewhere around 55 and a proteinuria of 1.2. Now, which one of the following would be the most appropriate antihypertensive therapy to help slow CKD progression? Now, this is very, very important. Which is the decision to slow CKD progression? So, for slowing CKD progression, which of the following options would you take? See, the BP is already well controlled. So, you think nothing to do. BP is well controlled. So, let it go on like this. Or you want to change the atenolol to ARB. Or you want to change the chlorothalidone to ARB. Or you want to add another ARB. Because I said ARB is the drug option. So what do you think would be the option over here? See, adding ARB to this might not be a very good option because it will decrease the BP way too much and that might not be very comfortable for the patient. She might have partial hypertension and all those things. There is definitive evidence to say in a patient who's having proteinuria, significant proteinuria in a diabetic kidney disease, the patient should be on some form of ACE inhibitor or ARB as much as possible. So the option is between B and C. So which drug you want to stop? So if you remember, management of hypertension. Nowadays, beta blockers are not a great drug for managing hypertension per se, unless and until you have some cardiovascular issues. So that's why the question clearly says she doesn't seem to be having any chest discomfort. So beta blocker over here for management of BP per se might not be a great option. So the best option over here would be changing the atenolol to an ARB. Okay. So continue the chlorothalidone, stop the beta blocker and put her on ARB. So that would be the ideal thing for this patient to prevent CKD progression. Okay. So this is the second caveat. So we have seen about BP control. The second caveat is, what is the antihypertensive of choice? The antihypertensive of choice would always be ACE inhibitor or ARB, especially in patients who are having proteinuric CKD. But see, this is easier said than done. Why am I saying this? So this is theory. So all textbooks will be saying this. But to tell you a practice point, especially in Indian patients and many times in both South and North Indian patients, most of our patients don't tolerate ACE inhibitors that well. So what do I mean by that? Whenever you start these patients on ACE inhibitor or ARB, their creatinine tends to rise. So a rise of up to 25% is considered okay. This happens because of certain hemodynamic changes that these drugs cause. But any rise above this, you would have to investigate the patient for renal artery stenosis. Again, the explanation for this, etc., is given in textbooks. I'm not going to go into the details of that. But the major issue which we face clinically would be the problem of hyperkalemia. Many patients, even when you put a small dose of ACE inhibitor, especially in diabetic kidney disease, develop significant hyperkalemia. And if you are not able to monitor the patient's potassium levels, that is when you start initially, when you are titrating the doses up, you're supposed to monitor the potassium almost once every week. If you're not able to call the patient back every week, or if you know the patient won't come back to you every week for testing the potassium, it's very difficult to start ACE inhibitor. So that's why you see many physicians and nephrologists might be very, very, very afraid to start this drug because of the fear of hyperkalemia. Because the patient develops hyperkalemia, you may even lose the patient to arrhythmias and all those things. So this fear is always there. So this always plays in the back of your mind. So why I'm stressing upon this, whenever you start a patient on ACE inhibitor ARB, you should do that. Always measure potassium also and make sure that it is not going way too high. That is not going above 5. If so, you might have to stop the drug and restart at a lower dose and slowly build up. Okay. So this is one side. The other side. So I had been to a conference where we had one of the biggest names in nephrology, Professor Mani. So he's not practicing nephrology anymore, but he had some of his patients on up to 80 milligrams of ramipril. Now I have not been even able to give 5 milligrams of ramipril, but he says he was able to give his patients up to 80 milligrams of ramipril. And the principle he had followed was start low, go slow. So that's what he used to say. And monitor the patient closely, you will be able to go up. So if you're able to do that, great. Okay. So again, why should you prefer ACE inhibitor or ARB over beta blockers or the thiazides and all those things? Again, it's from various trials. So if you see these trials, again, the names are not that important. Initially, they had compared with placebo. Then they compared ACE inhibitor with another antihypertensive. Then people started becoming greedy. Why not we add both ACE inhibitor and ARB together? Now, see, ACE inhibitor ARB together is a strict no, at least for diabetic kidney disease. The reason being the chances of hyperkalemia and the chance of worsening AKI are very, very high. So it's usually not recommended to add both the ACE inhibitor and ARB together. So again, it's based on some classical trials. Okay, so I'll be talking about the trials in diabetic kidney disease a bit more towards the next 5-6 slides. So the next thing, so we have learned two concepts already, the third concept. So let's say you have a 48-year-old man, he's a type 2 diabetic. He has stable CKD, he's a CKD 3A, A2, okay. He's having hypertension, hyperlipidemia. He's on the preferred drug, losartan, 50 mg. This is a high dose of metoprolol, but okay, he's on 75 mg of metoprolol. He's on metformin as well. He's on atorvastatin. His BP seems to be okay, 121/68. Physical examination wise, nothing much. His eGFR is 52, okay. His HbA1c is 7.9, okay. So which one of the following interventions would be most likely to slow the progression of his CKD? Okay. So A, do you want to increase the losartan to reduce the BP to less than 120/80? Obviously not. We have already seen the target BP which you want to achieve is less than 130/80, which we have already achieved. So raising the losartan higher to have a lower BP doesn't really make sense because that won't do much benefit for the patient. No, metoprolol to dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker have no role over here because CCBs per se, especially DHP CCB per se, have not much role in CKD progression and all those things. Okay, so D, no changes. Or is it C? Okay, so the next concept is glycemic control. So we have seen BP control, preferred antihypertensive agents. The next thing is glycemic control. The recommended HbA1c to be targeted for these patients is 7. So this patient is 7.9. So you might have to change his diabetic medications to come to a acceptable glycemic control that would be less than 7. So the answer over here would be increasing metformin to target HbA1c of less than 7. So the next question, which many of you all would be thinking of metformin, EGFR, CKD. So usually when the GFR is less than 30, we don't prefer metformin. But if the GFR is greater than 45, we do give metformin because it's a good drug, especially if the patient has no complications like gastritis and all those things. Otherwise, we have to go to some other OHA or maybe preferably insulin. Okay. So the next caveat, goals of care in CKD, glucose control. The target HbA1c is 7%. And again, this target is not something which is written on stone. Okay. Again, this level will change according to the patient factor. So patients who are very frail, who have multiple comorbidities, who are having a higher severity of CKD and all those things, you might have to target a slightly higher HbA1c. Okay. So this obviously makes sense because you might have seen patients who are having CKD are at a higher risk for hypoglycemia than patients who don't have CKD. The reasons are very simple. There are two major reasons. One, insulin is metabolized by the kidney. So when the kidney fails, insulin metabolization doesn't happen. So you have a higher amount of insulin. That is, especially if you're giving exogenous insulin, and this can cause hypoglycemia. Two, renal gluconeogenesis. So kidney is an organ which is involved in gluconeogenesis. And when the kidney fails, gluconeogenesis doesn't happen. And that might be another reason for hypoglycemia. So worse degrees of CKD, try to have a slightly mild degree of glycemic control. Okay. Again, these are some of the, even for an MD level, glycemic control trials are very, very important. So you are supposed to know about what are the trial names for in which population it was studied and all those things. For an MBBS level, usually no one talks about trials, but these are some of the major landmark trials in glycemic control. Okay, you have the ADVANCE, ACCORD, UKPDS. Okay, so even if you don't remember the name, no issues, but I'll tell you, BCCT and EDIC were conducted in type 1 diabetics. UKPDS is in type 2 diabetics. Okay, so these are patients who have been followed up for a long period of time, more than 20 years, 25 years. So based on these trials, it has been found that when you have good glycemic control, you will have better microvascular complication outcomes. That is retinopathy, nephropathy, and all those things decrease. So we are going to concentrate only on nephropathy. So then people became a bit more greedy. So that's always happened. So why not 6.5% instead of 7? So when they try to decrease the control or make the control a bit more tighter, outcomes were not very good because hypoglycemic episodes were very high and we were losing patients. Patients were dying. So that's why this number of HbA1c of 7% has been achieved. Okay, so this is the table I was talking about. Okay, so I told you CKD is going to be predominantly diabetic kidney disease, and in the diabetic kidney disease there are four pillars, you can say two main pillars we have seen already. One is the glycemic control trials, so these are the ones which we are seeing. Two is RAS blockade, so we have again seen about RAS blockade, so you should try to put the patient on AC inhibitor or ARB. And see, the nephrologists have been trying very hard. So, because in spite of good glycemic control, in spite of giving AC inhibitor ARB, many patients have progressive CKD. So, we wanted to have a magic bullet. We wanted to have some other drug which can prevent the progression of diabetic kidney disease. So, we had tried many drugs. There was some drug called as paricalcitol. There were drugs called as sulodexide. There were drugs called as bardoxolin methyl. But unfortunately, all of them were negative trials. So, these are the name of some of those trials. So, those drugs have not come into clinical practice. After 20-25 long years, the nephrologists are all very excited now. So we are all excited for what drug. So we now have another class of drugs which has definitely shown to prevent worsening of diabetic kidney disease at least. So that class of drug is called as SGLT2 inhibitors. So now we are all very, very excited about this drug. So I want to talk a bit more about this drug. So this drug has come up in a big way over the past 3 to 5 years. So even Harrison doesn't talk much about this drug. So I want you to concentrate on this. So maybe within the next 1 or 2 years, this drug might be used in a greater way. Okay, so these are some of the trials based on which I'm telling you that SGLT2 inhibitor is the next big thing in nephrology, even in cardiology. Okay, so you need to know something about SGLT2 inhibitor. So again, we'll go to a clinical scenario. Let us say you have a 70-year-old woman, moderate obesity. So that's an important point. BMI of somewhere around 32, HbA1c of 8.2, CKD 3A2. Okay, history includes coronary artery disease, recurrent parenchylosis, and so you have decided to start her on SGLT2 inhibitor. which among the following is a very, very important risk factor which you should be aware of before giving the patient SGLT2 inhibitor? See, all of them are important. Okay, so there are case reports of acute kidney injuries. Severe hypoglycemia is not that common, but it can occur when you combine it with the sulfonylurea or insulin. In one of the trials, there was higher chances of lower extremity amputation with canagliflozin. Okay, but the next trial with canagliflozin called as Credence didn't show this. But all trials on SGLT2 inhibitors have been equivocal about one point, that is genitourinary fungal infections. Okay, so this is based on the mechanism of action of the SGLT2 inhibitor. So when I explain that, you'll understand. So when before you prescribe SGLT2 inhibitor to any patient, you should understand that these patients are prone for recurrent UTI, especially fungal UTI. So you should educate the patient regarding this complication before you prescribe SGLT2 inhibitor to them. So why should a hypoglycemic agent have so much of cardiac and renal protection? So the many reasons have been put forth. Okay, so it's based on these two things. So as you know, SGLT2. So what is that? So it is a sodium glucose symporter which is present in the proximal tubule. So this drug blocks the tubule, so you have loss of both glucose and sodium in the urine. So whenever you lose, you have loss of sodium and glucose in the urine, it's called as glycosuria and natriuresis, and that can result in all these various mechanisms and result in cardiac and renal protection. Okay. So I'll try to explain. So I'm sure all of you all remember your physiology. I'm sure most of you would have forgotten, but still I'll try to brush up your knowledge. So you have two pictures over here. So you have a diabetic nephron. So concentrate on the color part. So what happens in a patient with diabetic kidney disease? So what happens in a patient who's having diabetes and the kidneys have been affected with diabetic kidney disease? Because of hyperglycemia, you have increased loss of glucose. Okay. And what happens is because of the increased amount of glucose, all these transporters work overtime and they absorb all the glucose and sodium. So the amount of sodium which reaches the distal tubule is very less. Now remember, what is the reason why humans or mammals for that matter started developing kidneys? We were all marine creatures. Okay, from the sea, we all came to the land. So what is the evolutionary reason for kidneys? To preserve sodium. Okay, so that's what this tubuloglomerular feedback is all about. Okay, so when the amount of sodium which reaches the distal tubule goes very down, so it thinks that the body is having more sodium, so it will lead on to afferent arteriolar vasodilation. But this in turn leads to intraglomerular hypertension. So whenever you have intraglomerular hypertension, you'll have more proteinuria. Whenever you have more proteinuria, you'll have faster kidney damage. So you should prevent this. So what the SGLT2 inhibitors do? So now come to this side. So because this gets blocked, more and more amount of sodium is coming to the distal tubule. So now the kidney will think, oh my God, I'm losing all the sodium. I'm not supposed to be losing sodium. So the mechanism is it activates the tubuloglomerular feedback. It acts through the adenosine activation receptor. So this is again a very important MCQ question for you. And this results in afferent arteriolar vasoconstriction. So this leads on to a fall in GFR. So this is the reason for transient fall in GFR whenever you start SGLT2 inhibitor. Even for ACE inhibitor, this is the same reason. Okay. So this fall in GFR will lead on to some amount of sodium preservation. So that's what is the mechanism behind this. And this helps in preventing worsening proteinuria and worsening of renal outcomes. So when you have a decrease, when you have an afferent arterial vasoconstriction, the intraglomerular pressure doesn't increase. So there is not much of an increase in proteinuria and you have beneficial effects. Okay, so this is just one mechanism. There are many other mechanisms, but I'm just trying to explain one mechanism. This is the hemodynamic explanation for how SGLT2 inhibitor might have some benefit in preventing worsening of diabetic kidney disease. Okay, so now the entire picture from black and white has become color. So I hopefully you have understood this point. Okay, so this is another important slide. So how do you select for whom you want to give SGLT2 inhibitor? So it's important. So you still not studied in patients who are having EGFR of less than 30. So the patient should have an EGFR of greater than 30, and it's used preferably in patients who are having significant proteinuria and patients who are having recurrent heart failure. In these two categories of patients, you should try to use SGLT2 inhibitor as much as possible. But I told you about the potential contraindications. Never forget. So whenever you put the patient on SGLT2 inhibitor, you should talk to them about perineal hygiene. Okay, you should tell them. So in male patients, you should tell them retract your prepuce, clean the glands. Okay, in female patients also, you should tell them have proper perineal hygiene. And whenever they develop symptoms of UTI, come to you immediately. Try to stop the drug. Okay. Another important side effect which it can cause is something called as euglycemic ketosis. Go read about it. So I'm sure all of you would know about diabetic ketoacidosis. But what is euglycemic ketosis? So this can be asked as an MCQ for all. Among the following, which drug is known to cause euglycemic ketosis? SGLT2 inhibitor. Okay. And foot ulcers. I told you there are some papers which have shown that it can increase the rates of amputation. So that also is something you should always look. So whenever you're giving SGLT2 inhibitor to a patient, ask them about whether they have symptoms of urinary tract infection. Check their foot to see whether there is some ulcer. Check their peripheral pulses, whether they're having any peripheral artery disease and all those things. Never forget. And what are the drugs which have been studied? There are other drugs in the market, but the main three drugs are canagliflozin, dapagliflozin, and empagliflozin. So these are the dosages with which these drugs come. And you should always educate the patient. I've told about this. And the other important thing is hydration. Now, dehydrated patients are at a higher chance for AKA when you give them SGLT2 inhibitor for obvious reasons, because they're going to have osmotic diuresis and obviously AKA can worsen. So should ask the patient to remain well hydrated. Okay, so remember these points. So yeah, so these are the various trials on SGLT2 inhibitor and diabetic kidney disease or this thing. Okay, so one important trial would be CREDENCE. Okay, but now what has happened is the nephrologist and the cardiologist seeing the effect of SGLT2 inhibitor. Now we have become greedy. We are thinking that why not give SGLT2 inhibitors to patients who don't have diabetes also. So nowadays there are trials like the Emperor CKD and the DAPA CKD. So these are trials, okay, so which has shown that in patient, nowadays SGLT2 inhibitor is being used as an agent to prevent CKD progression even in non-diabetic patients. Okay, so that's the stage at which we are in. Okay, the one reason why many of you all might not see SGLT2 prescription is because of cost. Okay, it's slightly costly a drug, but in my opinion, it should be tried. Okay, it's such a great drug. Okay, the next question: a 60-year-old man with type 2 diabetes and CKD stage 4, A3. Okay, having a proteinuria of somewhere around 1,800. BP is given 126/70, lisinopril of around 40. He's on diltiazem as well and insulin glargine. So this is about another interesting agent. So which one of the following interventions would be appropriate to manage risk factors associated with CKD progression? So I told you there are two agents which you're all very much interested in. Okay, so one is SGLT2 inhibitor. The second one is called as GLP-1RA. So glucagon-like peptide 1 receptor agonist. So this is another agent which we are very much interested in. So this question is about that. So what do you want to do? Do you want to add metformin? But see, the patient is in CKD4. That means EGFR is less than 30. I told you if EGFR is less than 30, we don't give metformin. So that is out. Addition of GLP-1 receptor agonist to slow progression to KFRT. KFRT means kidney failure with requiring renal replacement or needing replacement therapy. So this is the new terminology for ESRD nowadays. Or is it addition of GLP-1 receptor to reduce BP? So GLP-1 receptor agonist has nothing to do with BP reduction. Okay. So the option is actually one. Okay. So though GLP-1 RA can cause hypoglycemia, they have been shown to retard CKD progression. So if possible, again, cost is the problem. If possible, you're supposed to add that agent. So a few words about GLP-1 RA. So it is a new class of anti-diabetic medication to improve renal outcomes. Okay. So it is not a new anti-diabetic class, but it has been shown to improve renal outcomes only recently. Okay. So how do these drugs act? So this is very important. And another important thing, why many patients are not willing for GLP-1 RA is because it's not an oral drug. It is an injectable drug. Okay. So you might know exenatide, liraglutide, lixisenatide. Okay. So these are some of the GLP-1 receptor agonists available in the market. But because it's an injectable drug, many patients don't like. But for you in MCQ, where I suspect GLP-1 RA might be asked is in this area. So this is a preferred drug for obese diabetics. Okay, so because it can promote weight loss and all those things. And another important thing which I want you all to remember is pancreatic and thyroid cancer. Okay, so this drug, that's why it has a FDA black box warning for pancreatic and thyroid cancer. So that's very important. And these are some of the names of the trials. Again, you need not remember the trial name. So this is a small flow chart. Okay, so so based on how do you start SGLT2 inhibitor or GLP-1 RA, based on the patient's proteinuria. So you have higher proteinuria or a very high risk of ASCVD, you try to give these drugs. Okay, and similarly for at what GFR, what dosage you would give and all those things. Okay, so the next question. Let us say you have a 54-year-old man. He's again a stage 4 CKD. Okay, so he's having good weight loss. He's having good BP. His BMI is 32. So what do you think about this BMI? HbA1c is around 7.2%. Uric acid is 8.1. Okay, so it has been predicted that he is having a 4.6% of kidney failure at 2 years. So there's a site. If you see in Harrison, even they talk about that website. You can go and check that website as well. Which one of the following intervention would be most appropriate? So do you think he should be referred for bariatric surgery? Do you think he should be put on allopurinol treatment? Or you want to target a BP of less than 120/80? Or do you think there should be no additional therapy? Okay, so if you see strictly from an evidence standpoint, the answer is, this is a googly question. Actually, the answer is no additional therapy because everything is at optimal levels. And though weight loss is recommended to improve glycemic control and all those things, there's no definitive trial evidence to suggest that it prevents CKD progression. And moreover, you don't do bariatric surgery at a BMI of 32 and all. Okay, so usually the BMI is slightly higher. So the answer over here would be no additional therapy. And what are the other factors? So that's what this question was based on. So smoking cessation, ask the patient to exercise well, weight reduction to optimal targets, lipid lowering therapy. Now, again, very important, dyslipidemia. So your cardiologist would come up in arms if you're not talking about dyslipidemia. So many of them might be needing statin. Again, the role of statin in CKD is a bit of a controversy, but you try to add whenever possible. And aspirin is indicated for secondary, but not primary prevention. Okay, so now coming on to the complications. So we have seen mostly about CKD management and progression. Now, a few words about complications of CKD. So I'm sure all of you know about the various complications of CKD, and one of the most important complications of CKD would be anemia. So Harrison gives a table telling what are all the reasons for anemia and CKD. So that's again a very exhaustive list. But I want you to understand two things. So whenever you see a patient with CKD and anemia, always work them up for iron deficiency. And if they have iron deficiency, treat them with iron. Either IV iron in a patient who is dialysis dependent or oral iron in a patient who's having CKD but is not dialysis dependent. Okay, so the thresholds for giving iron is slightly different from that in iron deficiency anemia. Okay, so even if the transferrin saturation, so what is transferrin saturation? Again, you can go back to your pathology books, it will be given. Or if the ferritin is less than 500, you are supposed to treat them with iron. And after that, once the patient is iron replete, you can start them on ESAs or erythropoietin stimulating agents. That is the erythropoietin or the adipoietin. So don't start the patient directly on erythropoietin without even checking the iron status. Better you don't do that. It's very simple. It is like a machine preparing garment, let's say. So your erythropoietin is that machine. Okay. For you to have a shirt or a garment, you need cotton or the raw material. So unless and until you have raw material, which over here would be iron, the shirt is not going to come. Okay. So no point in giving a patient erythropoietin or darbepoietin without supplementing the patient with iron if the patient is iron deficient. So that's why you should work up the patient for iron deficiency before you give them any erythropoietin and all those things. Now, CKD MBD is the most complicated and most difficult part in CKD management. But I want you all to remember only one key point over here. The most important thing which sets off the MBD in CKD is phosphate retention. Okay. See, the kidneys are the major organs which are involved in phosphate excretion from the body. Whenever the kidney fails, the kidneys don't excrete phosphate, and this leads on to phosphate retention. This leads on to various problems in the body, resulting in hyperparathyroidism and hypocalcemia. And this is referred to as secondary hyperparathyroidism. So if you know this much, it's more than enough for basics. And one more important thing is 1-alpha-hydroxylase. Okay, so just like erythropoietin, 1-alpha-hydroxylase is the other enzyme which is coming from the kidney. So when the kidney fails, 1-alpha-hydroxylase is not secreted adequately, and this results in problem again. Okay. Okay, so how do you treat CKD-MBD? Again, this is a separate topic per se, but to make it short for y'all, first thing would be to evaluate the vitamin D levels. That is the 25-hydroxy vitamin D levels. If there is deficiency, supplement. Okay. Nowadays, the main thing is to avoid giving active forms of vitamin D. And the other thing is phosphate binders. Now, see, many write phosphate binders right, left, and center, but the adequate doses are not written by many. Okay, so ideally speaking, if you have to give correct dose of phosphate binder, that is Sevelamer and all those things, it should be 2 to 3 drugs with every meal, but almost no one prescribes that level, and that level of drug will cause many complications also. And it's not a potent drug, okay? So the best thing would be to advise dietary management and avoid any form of packaged food and cola drinks and all those things. So they contain a lot of phosphate, right? But if you're many times with all these measures, you won't be able to manage phosphate once the patients cross CKD stage 4 and all those things. Then you might have to start counseling them for renal replacement. Okay. So this is a question regarding management of acidosis. So you have a CKD patient. Okay. Her bicarbonate is somewhere around 90 to 21. Okay. So what is true regarding treatment of metabolic acidosis in a patient with CKD? See, dietary supplementation with sodium bicarbonate doesn't decrease but increases bone mineral density. So B is wrong. Modest dietary protein restriction should increase skeletal muscle catabolism, which is wrong. It decreases skeletal muscle catabolism. So that's why in CKD patients, moderate dietary protein restriction is recommended. Patient should be on high protein diet. Again, so this is exact opposite of what we saw in C. So patient should not be on high protein diet, especially when they are having a CKD stage 4 and all those things. So the answer over here is A. Modest protein restriction should decrease urine ammoniogenesis, thereby reducing acidosis. So I just want you all to remember this. See, I've seen many times any CKD patient, whether you check the bicarbonate level or not, you just start the patient on sodium bicarbonate. Never do that. Any patient with CKD, measure the bicarbonate level, and if it's less than 22, you put them on sodium bicarbonate. And always remember, sodium bicarbonate has sodium in it. So it can result in volume overload and the resulting complications. So the patient might come back to you with edema and all those problems. So you might have to give them a small dose of diuretic. Remember this always. And diet in CKD. Now, this is one area which is highly misunderstood. So one food which we all say to avoid is fruit juices, tender coconut water, especially the food items which are rich in potassium. But many times, many senior nephro, what they say is don't eat anything. Don't see, like in Tamil Nadu, there's this thing, CKD is called as salt disease. So they say don't take salt. So the patient often come back to us and ask, sir, I'm not at all taking salt, then why am I having CKD, sir? So food, salt in food has nothing to do with CKD. I'm sure you all will understand that. So what I would suggest is always partner with a dietitian or a nutritionist. Okay, their role is very, very important over here. Don't tell the patient, don't take anything. If the patient doesn't take anything, he will have protein energy malnutrition, and that is a bigger killer than CKD per se. Okay, so a lower protein diet. Okay, try to avoid animal protein. But most of our people, they take once in a while. That is once in a week or once in 2 weeks is usually not a problem. And egg white usually is not a problem. And this is a major area, okay, CKD hyperkalemia. So I'm sure if you're MD postgraduate, you have seen many patients with CKD coming to you with hyperkalemia. Your treatment per se will lead on to hyperkalemia. So you should always tell them to reduce dietary potassium. So that's what I talked about, this fruit juices many fruits and all those things. So only fruits which we usually allow is apple, papaya, guava. Okay, so these fruits are usually allowed. The other fruits are usually asked to be avoided. And see, this is very important. Especially our ortho colleagues will make this mistake. Any patient comes to them with pain, the only thing they know is they will put an NSAID for the patient, even without seeing the creatinine, without seeing the GF or anything. So never do that. If the patient is before you put the patient on NSAID or anything, kindly check their RFT. And if the patient is having lower EGFR, better avoid the NSAIDs and put them on transplant and all those things. If the patient has hyperkalemia, obviously you'll have to stop ACE inhibitor ARB and restart at a later time if possible. And avoid substitutes which contain potassium. Okay, so how do you manage CKD? So in a nutshell, so what all I was saying, I'm just going to enlist them. So recognize and test patients who are at risk. Educate patients, very, very important. Manage blood pressure. So you know the blood pressure goals, you know the drug of choice. Okay, manage CVD risk factors. Because I've told you many patients will die of cardiovascular disease rather than progressing to ESRD. Monitor EGFR and ACR. Okay, evaluate and manage for complications. What are the complications we have seen? We have seen anemia, we have seen CKD, MBD, and various at-risk patients. So one area which I have not talked about much would be uric acid lowering therapy. So now there was in between many trials which was studied on using drugs like allopurinol or febuxostat to prevent the CKD progression. Unfortunately, none of these trials, like the CKD fix trial or the Pearl trial, had shown any benefit. Okay, so using hypouricemic agents just for reducing preventing CKD progression is really not recommended. But the patient having gout and all those things, then you can use. Okay, and the role of dietitian cannot be overstressed. So it's very important. Dietitian, you should always try to involve a dietitian if you have the luxury of a dietitian. Consider patient safety issues in CKD. So be careful when you prescribe drugs for the patients who are having chronic kidney disease. And nephrologists are your friends, okay, especially for the physicians. So whenever you have a problem in managing these patients, try to involve them, okay? So now, again, very important MCQ for you all. A 62-year-old woman, okay, recently diagnosed ovarian cancer, comes to the emergency department with urinary tract infection and atrial fibrillation. Medical history is notable for a CKD stage 4 A1, chronic hepatitis B. She's on lisinopril, she's on tenofovir, she's on multivitamin. CT imaging suggests a large ovarian mass with peritoneal carcinomatosis. The question is, which one of the following medications is safest to use in the setting of CKD G4? So I'm sure all of you know, aminoglycoside, one of the biggest nephrotoxic agents. Tenofovir also can cause renal issues. Cisplatin is also renotoxic. Amiodarone usually is not required. So the answer over here would be, usually amiodarone doesn't cause problem, but all other drugs can cause problem and might, you might have to put the patient on some other drug if some safe drug is present, or you give these drugs and monitor the renal functions closely. The next question. So this is a common scenario for which the nephrologists are called every time. 74-year-old man, CKD stage 4, IgA nephropathy, EGFR is somewhere around 23. Okay, they are planning for a lower extremity angiography. So basically, we are talking about contrast-associated kidney injury. What is the treatment of choice? Okay, so all these agents have been studied. N-acetylcysteine, HMG-CoA, S-reductase inhibitor, vitamin C, normal hydration. But the treatment of choice is normal saline hydration. Okay, again, someone is scribbling. So please avoid touching a screen. Okay, so the answer is actually normal saline hydration. That is the treatment of choice in this situation. So, okay, so this is not an exhaustive list. Okay, so this is not an exhaustive list, but some of the drugs where I've seen commonly being wrongly prescribed or prescribed in wrong doses for patients with CKD. So it includes allopurinol. So allopurinol needs dose modification in CKD patients. Gabapentin. See, all these patients are diabetic. They will be CKD. They'll be having diabetic neuropathy. They'll go to the neurologist. The first drug they'll put would be gabapentin or pregabalin without seeing the creatinine. If you give the patient, see, even 300 is what Western textbook says. Our patients, even a dose of 100 mg of gabapentin, they don't tolerate. 25 mg of pregabalin, they won't tolerate. You put the patients on these drugs, their creatinine, if their EGFR is less than 30, they will all become very drowsy. They won't be able to sit, they won't be able to stand, they will be always sleeping. So this is a common complaint with which the patient will come back to you. You just tell them, this drug should not be taken, they'll be fine. Okay, so be very careful. Metoclopramide, so you'll be prescribing perinorm to your patients. Okay, in CKD patients, you better avoid the drug because it can lead on to irreversible, what is EPS? It's not the former CM of Tamil Nadu, it is extrapyramidal syndrome. Okay, it can lead on to extrapyramidal syndrome. And narcotics, again, you should be a bit careful in prescribing narcotics to CKD patients. You should give them lower dose. What are the renally cleared beta blockers? Okay, so this is important for patients who are on dialysis. Okay, so for patients who are on dialysis, you better avoid these drugs and put them on drugs like carvedilol and all those things. Digoxin, we always try to not give for patients with CKD, or we give very, very low dose. Okay. As I told, statin also, these statins are not preferred. And enoxaparin, I'm sure all of you all would have used enoxaparin during this COVID pandemic. But in CKD patients, it's better not to use low molecular weight heparin, and it's better to use unfractionated heparin because, again, low molecular weight heparin is renal dose modification. Methotrexate and colchicine similarly. Okay. And one another drug I want you to tell is baclofen. So many CKD patients can have hiccups. So commonly many physicians like to add baclofen. But again, baclofen needs to not be given for CKD patient because it can again accumulate and result in lots of problems. The patient can become very drowsy and the patient might need even dialysis to remove the PET. So that's again very important. So what are the key points you should remember before giving medications to patients with CKD? Patients at high risk for drug-related events, so you should be ready to monitor them. You should see, it's almost impossible to know what are the dosage based on creatinine and all those things. all of us have smartphones. I would suggest you have the Medscape app or the UpToDate app, put in the EGFR and see the dosage and prescribe the drug accordingly. Okay, so that is the easiest thing to do. Okay, so especially drugs which are renally eliminated will need dose modification. And try to minimize pill burden. So what do I mean by that? Towards the end, I'll be explaining. And tell the CKD patients not to take painkillers. Avoid dual RAS blockage. So this can happen, especially when patients are seeing multiple doctors. They might be following your prescription and the prescription of others also. So try to get all the prescriptions and form a common prescription for the patient and give. So this is one area where I've burned my finger multiple times. And any medicine with greater than 30% renal clearance problem needs dose adjustment. So you should be a bit careful. And the last two points are a bit controversial nowadays, but yeah, the standard teaching is to avoid gadolinium contrast if the patient's EGFR is less than 30. The newer gadolinium seems to be safe, but yeah, if you can avoid, you better avoid, and avoid bisphosphonates also if possible. So this is, if you follow all the measures which I've told you, this will be there. Okay, the patient will be having a baseline rate of renal function loss, but if that doesn't happen, let us say the patient gets NSAID for gout, there's a sudden drop in GFR. Contrast given for coronarization, again a drop. Infection treated with aminoglycoside acid, one more drop. You give a patient diuretics and ACE inhibitor when the patient is in hypertension, one more drop, and the patient will come into ESRD very rapidly. Okay, so all these, if preventable, you should try to prevent. But sometimes it might not be preventable. For let us say the patient is having an MI, okay, and he needs a PCA to save his life. At that time, you cannot go and tell, no, kidney is not functioning, so don't do PCA. No. So it is always based on risk and benefit. If the benefits are outweighing the risk, you have to go ahead by explaining to the patient that he's at an increased risk for renal function worsening. So what you will be planning to do. So what are the indications for referral? So this is somewhat similar to the indications to start dialysis, which is much more important. So if you see in this entire exhaustive list, it's not in one place where creatinine value is mentioned, but that's the common reason for which we are called. Sir, creatinine is very high, sir, please do dialysis for this patient. Okay, so usually renal replacement therapy or dialysis is given to a CKD patient when uremia results in some clinical issue like pericarditis or uremic encephalopathy or a uremic bleeding, refractory volume overload, that is volume overload which is not responsive to diuretics, persistent hyperkalemia, that is medically resistant hyperkalemia. I'm sure we all know the management of hyperkalemia when medical management of hyperkalemia is not working. Or if the patient is having persistent symptoms which are attributable towards uremia, in that case, you might have to start the patient on renal replacement therapy or dialysis. Okay. So I think we have covered most of the treatment part of CKD. So now issues. Now see, CKD labeling. Now this is a big problem. See, I told you the patient should be having renal dysfunction. So let us say you're seeing the patient for the first time. The creatinine is high, the patient's having some renal dysfunction, and the patient has no previous report. So based on a single value of creatinine, it's very difficult to tell for you whether the patient is having an acute kidney injury or a chronic kidney disease. So that is why whenever you see a patient in the emergency for the first time, and if you see an elevated creatinine value or some renal dysfunction, always try to collect for baseline data. If you have a baseline data, and let us say 1 month back or 2 months back, the patient has done an RFP and that was normal and this is abnormal, then this is probably an AKA, not a CKD. But if it's been persistently high, then it's probably a CKD rather than AKA. So, okay, so based on this, so this is what I call about difficulty in labeling. So this is there with nephrology always. Role of renoprotective. So if any one of you are practicing physicians, so there are many drugs in the market which very catchy names. I don't want to tell the names like... So many people like writing these drugs. Okay, so these are like nutraceuticals. So they are supposed to help the patient. Okay, but unfortunately, there have not been any good quality trials to suggest that these drugs help. So I would kindly say avoid these drugs if possible. They don't do harm, but I have not written these drugs for any patient. So better to avoid these unnecessary drugs like Nefrosave, Renosave, Avetox, all these catchy names. But unfortunately, none of these drugs have been shown to be of benefit in good quality studies. And the next important point, diuretic dosing in CKD. Now see, diuretics, especially loop diuretics like furosemide, that is Lasix, they are loop diuretics which act on the luminal side of the renal tubule. So I hope you understand what is the luminal side. So the drug should reach the luminal side only if it is secreted or filtered, in this case secreted. So in a patient who's having significant renal dysfunction, if you give them a low dose of diuretic, nothing is going to happen. So you have to give them high dose of diuretic. So the common thing scenario which we face is the patient would be a CKD patient who would have come to the casualty with volume overload and short of the breath and pulmonary edema. And the patient would be getting some 10 mg of Lasix. So that won't do anything. The patient needs at least 40 to 80 mg and according to BP and all those. So the patients with CKD need a higher dose of diuretic, very important. Uric acid, I've talked about uric acid. Unfortunately, hypouricemic agents don't seem to be of great benefit in preventing CKD progression. Very important, investigate before treating. Okay, don't treat patients based on presumptions. Like any CKD patient, you should always give them iron, you should always give them erythropoietin, you should always give them vitamins, not like that. Always investigate them before you're treating. Okay, so what do you mean by a step care approach? Okay, so in a normal person, for example, an ADPKD person, he might be looking normal, but he is at a risk for progression to end-stage renal disease in his fifth or sixth decade. So always try to keep them in follow-up. So in a patient who's having increased risk, so what do you mean by these patients? Diabetic patients. So they're all at a chance for hypertensive patients. They're all the chance of developing CKD in the near future. So monitor them appropriately. Okay, and tell them avoid NSAIDs and all those things if possible. So patients who are in the early stages of CKD, find the cause and treat. If the patient is having hypertension, control the BP to the target levels. If the patient is a diabetic, try to maintain a good glycemic control, okay, so that you're able to slow the progression. But let us say the patient has gone into stage 4 or stage 3 CKD. Now try to look for complications of CKD, whether the patient is having anemia, whether the patient is having NVD or hyperkalemia, electrolyte abnormalities, fluid abnormalities. Try to seek them, treat them. And important, prepare the patient for renal replacement therapy. So once the patient has gone into stage 4 of CKD, start talking to them about dialysis. Start talking to them about renal transplant. Okay, if the patient is really a good patient, try to get an AV fistula done if the patient is willing for hemodialysis. So that when the patient has kidney failure, he is ready for renal replacement therapy. If you follow these things properly, it's very unlikely the patient will land up with death. Otherwise, that can always happen. So I want you all to remember this step care approach to CKD. Okay, so this in short tells about the entire thing which we were discussing. So before we end, a few Q&A. Okay, so again, it's a recap of what we had seen. So a 56-year-old female visits clinic. She's distraught. Okay, that another doctor who has seen her has said that she's having stage 3 CKD. She looked up on the internet. So this is very, very common nowadays. And she's afraid that she will need dialysis. She has 20-year history of hypertension and creatinine somewhere around 1.3. So what do you want to do? So you want to do something called as a cystatin C level. So I'm introducing a new thing. Go and read about cystatin C. You want to do a 24-hour urine creatinine clearance or encourage her to get another doctor. Okay, so some people even do that, but don't do that. The rational thing would be to reconfirm. Okay, so repeat the creatinine and measure eGFR. So based on eGFR, classify the patient. Okay, so you have a patient with a past medical history of type 2 diabetes. Okay, the patient is having hypertension, dyslipidemia, and comes to the clinic. The patient is on insulin, BP is slightly on the higher side, right? 150 by 90, creatinine is 2.1, PCR is around 1.5. So the patient is having proteinuria. So what is the next step in management? Do you think only medication, no medications for now? Or do you want to start medication? Obviously, I told you BP control is very important. So medication would be necessary over here. And we have already seen the drug of choice is a AC inhibitor or ARB, not both together. So the better option would be B and not 2. Okay. So a few questions on complications of CKD. So you have a 60-year-old male with past medical history of diabetes, okay, hypertension, dyslipidemia, on the preferred drug of lisinopril, which is an ACE inhibitor. He's having a low hemoglobin, PSAT of 18%, ferritin is 100. So obviously from this, you can see that he's having iron deficiency. I told you if the PSAT is less than 30% or if the ferritin is less than 500, you should supplement the patient with iron. So the best answer over here would be start the patient on oral ferrous sulfate. What about the other option? See, age-appropriate investigation should always be done. Any male greater than 50 years having iron deficiency anemia, you are supposed to load GAB. So colonoscopy would be necessary. So it's not unnecessary, it is necessary. Okay, he is a candidate for darbepoetin and all those things only after you have replaced iron. We have seen this concept clearly. So a question on MBD. So you have a patient So we are seeing step by step. So he's on insulin, lisinopril, he's getting ESA and IVN, and PTH is seemingly high. Okay, phosphate is also high, calcium is also high, which is false, which is not right. So normalization of bicarbonate level might delay ESRD onset. That is true. We have seen if the patient is having acidosis or low bicarb, you should give them sodium bicarbonate. Persistent metabolic acidosis may lead to malnutrition. Very true. You should not have persistent metabolic acidosis. He needs to be started on phosphorus binders. Seems so. The phosphate levels are high, and we are hoping that he's already done dietary restriction, all those things. He's definitely not a candidate for active vitamin D because his calcium levels are high. Okay, so I told you, usually CKD patients have hypocalcemia, but especially patients who have received calcium and all those things for various reasons can have hypercalcemia. Why calcium-based phosphate binders and high calcium load is to be avoided in patients with CKD is because of the risk of vascular calcification, which is again a problem with cardiovascular disease and acute coronary syndrome. So that's why we are saying avoid calcium supplements in patients with diabetes and CKD. Okay. Finally, so some of you all might be preparing for PGHCl exam. So what do you mean by a PGHCl affection? So multiple options can be right. So let us say you have a 40-year-old male with a past medical history of well-controlled diabetes, creatinine of 7.6, hemoglobin is normal now. That is an oddity. Bilateral normal size kidney and a urine protein creatinine ratio of 4.6. There is no baseline RFP. This is a common scenario if you come to your OPD. So what would you do for him? Would you ask for a fundus? Would you want a urine pathological examination? Would you start the patient on dialysis? Would you want to do a renal biopsy or will you do a AV fistula creation? Now see, this is very clear. The patient is having only one value of creatinine, that is very high, but he's having a normal size kidney. He's also having diabetes. Okay. Many patients with diabetic CKD will be having normal size kidney. So diabetic CKD is one area where where kidney size cannot help you in saying whether it's AKA or CKD. But one thing which can help you or guide you would be a fundus examination, because usually retinopathy comes together with nephropathy. And if the patient has no retinopathy, then this renal dysfunction might be due to some other cause. So you might need to do some other investigation. What is that some other investigation? So renal biopsy might be necessary. And obviously, you will try to do a urine pathological examination. So A, B, and D are definitely yes. C is a plus or minus. So if the patient has no symptoms per se, you might not do dialysis. But if I was supposed to answer this, I would go for A, B, and E. Definitely, I want to AV fistula because I still don't know whether the patient is having CKD. So when I don't know whether the patient is having CKD, the question of creating AV fistula does not arise over here. So the best options would be A, B, and D. C, plus or minus. Based on the data which is given, dialysis doesn't seem to be necessary, because I told you dialysis is not decided based on creatinine value, but based on the clinical manifestation. At least in the history, they have not given any clinical manifestations to start dialysis immediately. So a few spotters. So unfortunately, we are not able to interact. So I'll just tell you what this is. So this is a common presentation in our country. Many patients come to you in the very, very late stages. Okay, so this is a skin manifestation of CKD. This is called as a uremic frost. Okay, so the creatinine of this patient was very, very high, more than 30. So this is again a very important spotter. So nephrology unfortunately is not a great spotter friendly subject, but this is one spotter which we have. So this is called as a Lindsay nail or the half and half nail. Okay, so you should always examine the nails of a CKD patient. You'll be able to pick up these findings. So see, this when you see it casually looks like a case of pulmonary edema, right? But to tell you the history, you'll understand. So this patient was absolutely asymptomatic. No symptoms of shortness of breath, was able to lie flat, but he had this picture on the X-ray. So what is this called? So if you go and see the table in Harrison on ARDS or non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, so one cause is uremia. So this is called as uremic lung, okay? And this is a interesting case. So this patient had chest pain and he had a very significant uremia. Okay. So when you examine the patient, what is the clinical finding you would be able to find? So the clinical finding you should be able to find in this patient is a pericardial rub. This patient is having pericarditis. See, you are having this PR depression and concave sloping ST and all those things. Okay. So I told you one of the manifestations of advanced uremia is pericarditis. So whenever a patient is having very elevated urea creatinine, auscultate them and try to pick up pericardial rub. And pericardial rub is an indication for initiating RRT. It's an important point you should know. And this is the classical finding in a patient with CKD. So this is called the Rugger Jersey spine. And there's one more bonus finding, which is aortic calcification. I told you vessels in a patient with diabetic CKD is usually very bad and you can have calcification. So what you see over here is alternating hyper and hypolucency. Okay. So this is called as the Rugger Jersey spine, which is suggestive of renal osteodystrophy and the actual finding of aortic calcification as well. So finally, to wrap everything up, few take-home points for you. So identify the risk factors of CKD. Always educate the patient. Okay. Calculate eGFR. Calculate eGFR. Okay. So this is one take-home point I want you all to have. Adjust the medications appropriately for CKD patients. Dietary modification, very important. Okay. Get the help of a dietitian if needed. Avoid unnecessary prescription as much as possible. Okay. Nephrologists can be your friend, so always include them in patient management. Stress to the patient regarding need for regular follow-up. Now, this is one thing which we all forget. See, unfortunately, CKD doesn't have any symptoms. So the patient will not have symptoms unless and until the kidney is totally becoming dysfunctional. Okay, so in the early stages of CKD, patient will not have any symptoms at all. So if you don't tell them, you should check your RFT or come and meet the doctor at least once every 3 to 6 months, they won't do that. Okay, so stress for the need for regular follow. I think that's the last thing. So thanks a lot. So I thought I'll finish off with a couplet. Okay, so even the Prime Minister talks about Thirukkural. So this is a Thirukkural, one of the very important Thirukkural. So it says, Eppurul yar yar vai ketpinum appurul meipurul kaanbadarivum. So what does that mean? To discern the truth in everything by whomsoever spoken is wisdom. Okay, so I want you all to go and read Harrison now after this class. So based on the knowledge which you have gained now, when you read Harrison right now, you will be able to pick up many new points which you might have missed earlier. So this is what many of our seniors used to say, your eyes cannot see what your mind does not know. Okay. So now once you know these concepts, when you go and read Harrison or when you go and read about CKD and all those things, you'll be able to pick up many new things. Okay. So I think we come to the end of the class with that. And I've also given my mail ID and my number. So if you have any comments or any feedbacks or any doubts, you can mail me. I'll try to get back to you or even message me if it's possible.